tonight. Winning the Trump friendship sweepstakes, sold into marriage, and...
I mean, I have no problem saying that I did accidentally vote in two states.
Canadian police have arrested the person who they suspect drove a van onto a busy sidewalk in Toronto this afternoon and mowed down pedestrians. At least 9 people were killed and 16 were injured. In media reports, some witnesses said the incident appeared deliberate.
He hit every single person on the sidewalk. Anybody in his way, he would hit. The bus stop, everything got shattered. There was a lady in there that I saw. I just stopped and I looked and all I see is just crumbling up one by one, one by one. Holy God, I've never seen a scene like this in my life, I swear.
The Nashville Waffle House shooter is in custody. Travis Reinking allegedly killed 4 people at the breakfast restaurant yesterday morning. Last year, he crossed a security barrier at the White House and had his guns taken away.
After the incident at the White House, every federal resource was brought to bear, ensuring that he did not have the ability to purchase or own weapons, and that those weapons were taken.
Officers found Reinking today hiding in the woods with a handgun in his backpack. South Korea stopped blasting K-pop and anti-Pyongyang propaganda from loudspeakers on the northern border. It's one in a series of gestures to set the mood ahead of high-level talks about denuclearizing the Korean Peninsula.
이번 조치가 남북 간 상호 비방과 선전 활동을 중단하고 평화 새로운 시작을 만들어 나가는 성과로 이어지기를 기대합니다.
North Korea is also pausing missile tests and closing a nuclear test site. After 10 days of protests, Armenians celebrated getting their prime minister to resign. Serge Sargsyan took over as prime minister less than a week ago, which his opponents denounced as a power grab, since he had just spent 10 years as president. Southwest Airlines is canceling dozens of flights, a week after a mid-air explosion on one of its planes killed a passenger. A spokesman told Vice News they're canceling the flights to conduct voluntary engine fan blade inspections. The airline wouldn't confirm how many flights will be grounded, but the website FlightAware shows Southwest canceled 129 flights today alone.
French President Emmanuel Macron arrived at the White House tonight for the first Trump-era state visit. Getting the first state visit of Trump's term is a big deal. Macron's the unlikely winner of the foreign leader Trump stakes, and he beat out a lot of other heads of state using a simple 3-part strategy. Number one, to get Trump's attention, you have to talk like him.
I'm here to serve my people and my country and make it great again. As somebody I know very well could say.
Macron's not the only world leader who's tried it. Japan's Prime Minister Abe presented Trump with hats that say, Donald and Shinzo, make alliance even greater. But Macron is shameless with it. And that seems to have worked. Number two, all presidents like to think they're the most important person in the world. When it comes to Trump, world leaders are happy to oblige. Saudi Arabia had the early lead here. When Trump visited, the kingdom's leaders beamed his face onto the side of the Ritz. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu used Twitter after Trump spoke at the United Nations. In over 30 years in my experience with the UN, I never heard a bolder or more courageous speech.
We need to defeat the enemies of humanity and unlock the potential of life itself.
Macron's offering a special dinner in a fancy Eiffel Tower restaurant. Number three, if you got it, work it. That's the key to this round. The Saudis, again, had a lot to bring to the table here. Namely, they let Trump touch their precious orb. China offered something called a State Visit Plus, which included a special president's-only tour of Beijing's Forbidden City. But only one showcase of national treasure seemed to stick in Trump's mind. The military parade organized by Macron. Trump now wants one of those for himself. So Macron now finds himself the winner of the first Trump-hosted state dinner. His visit to the United States includes a trip with the president to Mount Vernon and lunch with Mike Pence at the State Department. You know, the good stuff. Trump and Macron have shared a lot of photo ops. But does that mean that Macron has clout? On April 15th, he told French TV that he had convinced his buddy Trump to change his mind on Syria and remain committed to military action in the country for, quote, the long term. It didn't take long for the White House to smack that down. Macron hopes all this pageantry means he has Trump's attention, so he can get what he wants from the president. But just because Macron and Trump will be in the same room doesn't mean Trump is actually listening to anything Macron has to say.
Mike Pompeo's nomination to be Secretary of State squeaked out of committee this evening.
Foreign Relations Committee will come to order.
After Senator Rand Paul changed his mind and said he was a yes. That reversal offset flip-flops from Democrats, who'd supported Pompeo for his current post running the CIA.
Mike Pompeo has already been confirmed to serve in Trump's cabinet once, so you'd think this time would be a cakewalk. But Secretary of State is a very different job from CIA director. It's about working with global leaders through diplomacy, not spying on them, and promoting US interests abroad, not uncovering our enemies' secrets. So now he's facing new opposition from some Democrats who supported him before. Of the 14 Democratic senators who voted to approve him as CIA director, at least six are now opposed to him for Secretary of State.
It's my understanding that
Gene Shaheen and Tim Kaine are both members of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and had the opportunity to grill Pompeo during his confirmation hearing. Both of them raised his past comments on everything from Muslims and terrorism to women's rights. This is how Kaine explained his change of heart.
We have a president who is anti-diplomacy, and I worry that Mike Pompeo has shown the same tendency to oppose diplomacy.
And Shaheen put out a statement saying her problem with Pompeo was his deeply conservative views on social issues. Despite all the new opposition, though, Pompeo is pretty much guaranteed to be confirmed in a full Senate vote. But the controversy around his nomination could still cause him trouble in the job. I talked to Brett Bruhn, a former diplomat who led the White House Office of Global Engagement under President Obama.
It weakens him on the world stage. He clearly does not have the backing that every other Secretary of State has enjoyed. Foreign leaders need to know that the Trump administration, that Mike Pompeo, have the leverage in Congress to get things done and to ensure, quite frankly, that members of Congress are not going to impede key foreign policy priorities.
That's going to be a particularly big deal for the top priority on Pompeo's plate once he's confirmed, North Korea. Pompeo has already met with Kim Jong-un as America's top spy. Now, as Secretary of State, he's going to have to show Kim that he can deliver his end of whatever deal the two countries strike.
Kris Kobach is the Republican Secretary of State in Kansas, but you may know him as America's voting cop, determined to find people he and President Trump claim undermine elections.
In many places, like California, the same person votes many times. You probably heard about that. They always like to say, oh, that's a conspiracy theory. Not a conspiracy theory, folks. Millions and millions of people.
Trump handpicked Kobach to help lead the so-called Voter Fraud Commission last year, before it dissolved in January following multiple lawsuits. And Kobach himself was just found in contempt of court for disobeying a court order in a recent voter registration case. But he's still looking to prosecute people in Kansas for election-related crimes. And he just nabbed one.
Bailey McCoy is a 20-year-old from Colorado. She's a junior at Fort Hays State University in Kansas, where she competes in breaking rope and barrel racing on the school rodeo team. But according to Kris Kobach, Bailey is also an outlaw. In 2016, she voted twice in the presidential election, casting ballots in both Kansas and Colorado.
How did you end up casting two ballots?
Well, I had gone home one weekend to Colorado for a barrel race, and my mom had gotten our mail-in ballots, so I went ahead and filled it out at home, and I signed it, and I just left it on our table and didn't do anything with it. And then I went back to Kansas, and then I got excited to go in and vote, so I went in and voted, and then didn't remember about my mail-in ballot in Colorado. My mom had called me a couple days later and said that she had sent in my mail-in ballot, and we kind of realized then that I voted twice.
And I didn't know what to do at that point. You know, there's not really protocol when you've done something like that, so.
In January, Kris Kobach filed two felony charges against Bailey, election perjury and voting more than once, the latter of which carried a jail sentence of up to 13 months. Kobach is the first and only Secretary of State in the country who can prosecute voting-related crimes. He convinced the legislature to give him that power 3 years ago, citing widespread voter fraud. But since then, he's charged just 15 people. Bailey, who enlisted the help of a lawyer, is the latest.
I think Mr. Kobach needs to justify his prosecutorial powers. And so he will have to prosecute every case that he finds. The fact that he's only found 15 cases in the time that he's been able to prosecute suggests that it's really not a problem.
He makes this argument that cases like Bailey's are the tip of the iceberg, you know, that I'm finding 10, 11, 12 instances of illegal voting, and therefore there could be thousands more cases.
I think he's out fishing for tuna, and all he's catching is the dolphins. And Bailey and the 10 or 11 other people who've been charged in this case are the dolphins. Now, it may be that there are just no tuna out there to catch.
The Secretary of State's office eventually agreed to a plea deal, and Bailey's felony charges were dropped to one misdemeanor that stays on her record. She paid a $500 fine.
Okay. Thank you.
Take care.
Thanks.
See ya. Bye.
Kobach's office refused to respond to Vice News about this story, but he has said that he will continue to prosecute cases of voter fraud.
Ultimately, you did break the law.
Right.
What do you think would have been sort of a reasonable punishment for what you did?
I mean, I understand paying the fine, and I mean, I have no problem saying that I did accidentally vote in two states. That's not what I'm trying to deny at all.
And had you heard of Kris Kobach before all of this?
Nope, I had not.
I thought who we would be looking for is non-citizens voting, or, you know, you hear stories of they go into cemeteries and look for deceased individuals and vote, you know, incorrectly that way. But to me, that's not what he's finding, and I don't understand why he continues.
Instead, Kobach found an all-American Republican who voted twice for Donald Trump.
Has this changed how you feel about voting and your, you know, the democratic process?
A little bit, yeah. It's definitely, I'll definitely make sure that nothing extra gets sent in for my next vote.
So you will vote again, you think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Not for Kris Kobach.
According to the UN, the prevalence of child marriage is declining around the world. But in parts of Africa, it's actually becoming a bigger problem. The Central African Republic has the second highest rate of child marriage worldwide. 29% of girls are married by the age of 15, and 68% are married before they turn 18. Benicia Zanga Rodriguez is only 12 years old. And just weeks ago, her family married her off to Chari Kobe, a 46-year-old unemployed driver. In exchange, they got a dowry of about $70, along with some goats and chickens. Now she cooks, cleans, and sells food at the market each night. She also has to take care of Kobe's 10-year-old daughter from his first marriage. We spoke to Benicia with permission from her parents. The legal age for marriage is actually 18, but girls can be married earlier if their parents say it's okay or a court approves. There's been violent conflict in the Central African Republic since 2013, when rebels overthrew the government. The instability and accompanying poverty is helping drive up the number of child marriages. Many families need the money a dowry provides and believe marrying their girls off at a young age can protect them from the sexual violence that's become an instrument of war.
Tu sais que c'est le groupe armé, même avec la force, il peut enlever l'enfant. Mais si elle est chez elle, elle a marié un seul homme, là, peut-être tout le monde savait qu'elle est déjà chez elle, donc son mari va occuper d'elle. Et puis nous aussi, on savait que s'il y a quelque chose, on doit venir demander son mari.
Amadou Djabi arranged the marriage for his younger sister, Zubeda. The 12-year-old recently gave birth to a baby girl. We also spoke to her with the consent of her parents. Zubeda says what pains her the most is the opportunity she's missing out on.
Today, the European Commission decided to open an investigation into Apple's $400 million purchase of Shazam, an app that lets you use the mic on your smartphone to identify the music playing around you. Shazam has been around since 2002, and it's been downloaded over a billion times. The move is part of Apple Music's attempt to overtake Spotify as the number one streaming service. When Apple launched Apple Music in 2015, Spotify already had 20 million paid monthly users. Today, Apple Music still has 30 million fewer subscribers than Spotify. But the Wall Street Journal reported it's growing faster than Spotify and could overtake it by this summer. And Shazam may give Apple another advantage in the form of data. A lot of data about what people are listening to and where, and what songs are being Shazammed so much they'll soon be featured in beer commercials.
Shazam has spent more than a decade collecting tens and hundreds of millions of data points. Because it's collecting the data on people Shazamming music, it's normally music that hasn't yet quite broken through. And that gives Apple, via Shazam, a unique data set which nobody else has. It's a way of helping predict hits.
The commission said it's examining whether Apple could get commercially sensitive data about the customers of its competitors, like Spotify or Tidal. The commission wouldn't specify exactly what that data is. But Apple could get more data on people who use Shazam on Android phones, which naturally has been harder for Apple to penetrate. It could learn what streaming services those Android users have installed and what songs they've looked up. Apple CEO Tim Cook has been critical of Facebook for its use of user data. But buying a data vacuuming service like Shazam could open Apple up to the same criticism.
That is fine. It don't sound like the strip clubs I would go to.
I
I fell in love with a dancer, dancer. Throwing all this cake, ooh, it's your birthday, girl. I like that girl. I'm in love, I'm in love, I'm in love.
Is that who I think it is?
Who do you think it is?
It's Flo Rida or something like that. Wow, that's crazy. He never really was like too hip hop though. He always was pop-ish. He always had like that. He had the, what do you have? The apple bottom jean. Ooh, with the fur.
Now you're looking for some love. You want some me so bad.
You so bad.
You want some me so bad.
Me so bad.
That's like the feel right now, like that tropical Caribbean sound. I've always been a fan of Caribbean music, but it's starting to align into like the pop music and hip hop culture at the same time. I'm actually happy that it's getting, you know, a little more recognition.
Although it's 70 hours.
To make these type of songs, man, you have to be going through something that makes you say these things, man. I like how you kept coming in with the ad-lib, like, even though it's 70 hours. You can really get lost in the sauce in L.A., man. So I get what my homie was saying, man, even though it's 70 hours. 70 hours? Wait, where are you driving from?
Oh, no, he said it's 70 out, like 70 degrees.
Oh, 70 out. Oh, facts.
Yeah, we straight, but if you wrinkle up the situation, he will go grab the iron, and he do what I says like Simon. And my bitch mix like jambalaya, and fuck with the fan. We in Japan, bitch, you a bum, so you don't understand. Yeah, I cut off some friends.
It was an automatic head nodding, like you just bouncing the whole time. He's being slick, too. What he's saying is slick. You got to catch it, you know what I mean? Who is it?
That's Tyler.
Wow, that's Tyler, the Creator? I never heard none of his music, man. Because he's on the internet so much, and like they always show him doing something crazy that I never really took the time out to be like, you know, what music does he make? You know what I mean? It's like a gift and a curse, man, because like I feel like a lot of these guys that's probably known for something else more than their craft or whatever, it's just something they allow to be, you know, put out there. I always took away that label. Like, don't call me a gay rapper. Don't even call me a female rapper. Like, I'm a lyricist. I spit.
That's Vice News Tonight for Monday, April 23rd.